First John was really specific on that. He says, how can you say you don't love, how can you say you love God if you don't love your brother? And we have a responsibility to love God and love one another. And that's the first part of our membership covenant. The second leg, leg that we're following is encourage one another. And to encourage one another is to, I like the word, to paraclete. Paraclete is the word for the Holy Spirit, the helper, the comforter, the encourager. We are supposed to come alongside of one another. That's what the Holy Spirit does for us, comes alongside of us. And there's times that the Holy Spirit just wraps his arm around us and just holds us close. And we just need him to be there to just comfort us. There's sometimes we need the Holy Spirit to say, come on, buck it up, puppy. Come on. You're starting to sin and you're starting to blow it, but you can get this back. Come on, follow Jesus. And we need that encouragement. We need that conviction that the Holy Spirit, who comes alongside of us, doesn't go and talk to other people. You know, the Spirit of God doesn't do that. The Spirit of God comes to us with the things that he wants to challenge us with and even convict us with. So we need to encourage one another, come alongside of one another, help one another. And then this week, we're at the third leg, and that is to grow as Christ's disciples. What did Jesus say when he's standing on that, at that final moment? He's there with his 11 disciples. He's just about to ascend into heaven. And he says, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. He says, look, he has become the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, and he's done that by dying on a cross and rising from the dead. And he's now about to leave the disciples, and he's already warned them, I've got to go. I've got to leave because I don't want to just have me be with you. I want my Spirit to be inside of each one of you. And so I'm getting ready to go, but now as I go, this authority that I have, I'm going to be passing it on to you, and you need to get out of here. And while you're leaving this place and wherever you're going out into the world, make disciples of all people, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey all that I have commanded you, and I am with you always to the end of the age. And with that, Jesus ascends into heaven, having given us this incredible commission. And we have a responsibility to go out and make disciples. But I keep thinking, though, that there's a challenge to that, isn't there? How many of us know how to make a disciple? How much sugar do you use? And how much flour? How many chocolate chips go into making a disciple? And what's the way? Do you spin it a few times? Do you shake it up? I mean, what? How do you make a disciple? Well, Jesus made 11 disciples. He actually made several others too. In fact, he started with the 12. Then he made 72 more. Then he made 120. And there were others who also called themselves disciples of Jesus Christ. Followers. What's the word? A disciple? A disciple is a learner. Somebody who's continuing to learn. How about, by the way, if you've made it, right? You've made it spiritually. You're there, right? You say, I'm there. I'm right on. I've got it going really good with Jesus Christ. I've made it. You stand up, okay? Well, if none of you have made it, who are we going to follow as our example? Because that's a part of what discipleship is about. Growing to become more and more like Jesus Christ. And as we're doing that, that's what Jesus was modeling for his disciples. And then he said, now you go and do the same thing. You go and model your relationship with me so that other people can follow that example and also become like Jesus Christ. There are some great studies out there and tools that people can follow. I've got Design for Discipleship and a number of others of them. But the bottom line is, it's not about a set pattern, a set course that you've got to take people through. You've got to be committed to relationship with one another, helping people follow Jesus as you follow Jesus. So you actually invite them, like Paul said. He says, follow my example as I follow the example of Jesus Christ. How many of you, by the way, are comfortable with doing that? You don't have to raise your hand this time. But seriously, think about that. How many of you are comfortable at turning to somebody else and saying, follow me as I follow Jesus Christ? Or how many of you would say, follow me most of the time, but not, there's sometimes I don't want you to follow because sometimes I'm not following Jesus, so don't follow. Paul says, follow my example as I follow the example of Jesus Christ. And what we want to learn how to do is how to keep growing and growing and growing as a disciple of Jesus Christ. So today we're going to look at Ephesians, the third chapter. We'll start at verse 10. I want to know Christ. Paul could have almost stopped right there. I want to know Christ. Yes, to know the power of his resurrection and participation in his sufferings, becoming like him in his death, and so somehow attaining to the resurrection from the dead. Not that I have already obtained all this or have already arrived at my goal, but I press on to take hold of that for which Christ Jesus took hold of me. Brothers and sisters, I do not consider myself yet to have taken hold of it. You guys are in good company, aren't we? Paul says, I haven't made it either. I haven't arrived yet either. But one thing I do, forgetting what is behind and straining toward what is ahead, I press on toward the goal to win the prize for which God has called me heavenward in Christ Jesus. All of us then who are mature should take such a view of things. And if on some point you think differently, that too God will make clear to you. Only let us live up to what we have already attained. Join together in following my example, brothers and sisters. And just as you have us as a model, keep your eyes on those who live as we do. I want to know Christ, Paul says. I probably need to remind us where Paul is sitting
or dictating this.
Sitting in a Roman cell. He's waiting to be killed for his faith in Jesus Christ. He knows he's within perhaps days, maybe even hours of his own death. He knows all the things that he's done throughout his life. Think about this. I want to know Christ. This is the one who got to see Christ like none of us have, right? He's blinded on the road to Damascus and hears his voice and follows him back to Damascus and then has this miracle where he's told that this man's supposed to come to him, Ananias, and speak to him, and then he's going to have the blindness taken away and he's going to know Jesus. That's this Paul. This is the Paul who when he referred to him as, I know a man, which we believe was Paul, who was taken up into heaven 14 years ago. I don't know if it was actually in heaven or it was just a vision, but I know a man who had that experience. This is Paul who's had that kind of supernatural experiences with God himself. This is Paul who's been shipwrecked and stoned and left for dead, and God's brought him back to life. This is Paul who's been able to go out there and witness to people and see hundreds upon thousands of people come to faith in Jesus Christ. This is Paul who's experienced miracles on end. This is Paul who's had God speak to him and tell him, hey, it's time to leave this place and go across the Macedonia. This is this Paul who's had so many amazing experiences. And what is he saying? I want to know Christ. We were at my nephew's wedding last night. Some of you saw my Facebook postings. And after the ceremony, Debbie made a comment about the ceremony. There were only a few times that their names were used, as David and Suzanne, in the ceremony. But one of them was a really cool one. Right at the end, after the pastor had said, "By the authority vested in me and by Jesus Christ and the state of California, I pronounce you husband and wife," he stopped. And then he said, "David, you may kiss your bride." What is David? The pastor, knows David and Suzanne, some and all. And it was, but yet it was still kind of an impersonal ceremony. However, who knows who there? Oh, David. David looks forward to knowing Suzanne. They met at a coffee shop. I met one of the ladies who was at their first date, because they were at some kind of a Super Bowl party on their very first date. And some of us have known David since he was born. But David and Suzanne are getting to know one another. And they will grow in that knowledge of one another if they continue to work at it the rest of their lives. I don't know about you, but do you think that they're planning on reaching some point in their relationship and then saying, "Okay, I know you well enough, I'm done"? I can say, after almost 42 years, it's coming, I still want to get to know her better. What's Paul saying? He's using the same kind of word, isn't he? He says, "I want to know Jesus. I want to know Jesus Christ more." It's interesting, the word that's used there, gnosis, for to know, is also a word that comes out in a negative way, for Gnosticism. Some of you have heard about Gnosticism. And it's people who got so much into knowledge that they got away from relationship. What Paul is saying, "I want to have a deeper, deeper relationship with Jesus Christ. I want to know Christ." I like the way the Amplified put it. It says, "For my determined purpose is that I may know Him, that I may progressively become more deeply and intimately acquainted with Him, perceiving and recognizing and understanding the wonders of His person more strongly and more clearly. And that I may in that same way come to know the power overflowing from His resurrection, which exerts over believers. And that I may so share in His sufferings as to be continually transformed in spirit into His likeness, even to His death." I want to know Christ. Do you have that hunger? Not just to know about Him, not just to memorize verses, not to just have religious knowledge, but do you have that hunger to know Jesus more? I sometimes feel frustrated because I'm like, how do I help us to grow in that hunger more for Jesus Christ? How do I increase our passion for Jesus Christ? I don't want us just to come to church. I want us to have this deepening, stronger, loving, heartfelt relationship to intensify with Jesus Christ. I want to know Jesus. Paul goes on, he says, "I want to know the power of His resurrection." And this is a man who's experienced it in multiple different ways. He saw the risen Christ on the road to Damascus. He's one born like illegitimately, as he says. I want to know the power of his resurrections. You see, disciples want more than just knowledge of the resurrection. Oh yeah, he rose from the dead. No, they want to experience the power of that resurrection. Paul even prayed for the Ephesians. He prayed that they'd be able to grasp the incredible love of God, how deep and wide and special it is, and that they'd have the power of the resurrection. Did you get that in Ephesians? When he's praying for him, he says, I pray that you'd have the power, resurrection power, to be able to grasp how deep and special God's love is. That's something more intense. That we would have resurrection power to understand God's love. I want to know the power of his resurrection. And then he comes to one that I'm sure that all of you are really looking forward to. You've probably prayed this, right? I want to participate in your suffering, Jesus. Really? How many of you look forward to pain? Come on, there must be some shy ones who just really, you're hoping to really suffer for Jesus' sake, right? That's what Paul's saying. You see, few of us want to know Christ really like Paul's asking for, if we're really honest. Because he wants to experience the same suffering that Jesus Christ experienced when he died on the cross. I want to know the pain that he felt, Paul says. I want to know the love that he felt when he went to that cross for me. I want to experience what he experienced when he was abused and beat and persecuted. I want to know that kind of suffering like Christ suffered. Well, fortunately for Paul, he's going to get to experience it within days, as he will literally die for Jesus Christ. But hasn't he already experienced it? Go back in just earlier in Ephesians and look at the various things that Paul says about himself that give him credibility. Shipwrecked, stoned, persecuted, imprisoned, sick, all kinds of bad things happening to him. He's experienced the suffering of Jesus Christ. And he said, I still want to experience more of that. Because why? I want to be closer to Christ. I want to know Jesus. Johnny Erickson Tada. Most of you know who she is. Johnny Erickson Tada. She's crippled when she was like 16 or so, a young teen. And back injury, total spinal cord break that caused her to be in a wheelchair the rest of her life. But she learned how to draw by putting some bracelets on her arms and with her mouth, and has had a great ministry and all to the suffering. Johnny says, all I care for is to know Christ. Yes, we agree with the apostle. We'd like to know Jesus better, to be on good terms with him. All I care for is to experience the power of his resurrection. Absolutely. Who wouldn't want the Lord's power in his or her life? All I care for is to share in his suffering. Sure. I guess tough times in moderate doses isn't all that bad. We all need a good soul scrubbing now and then. All I care for is growing conformity with his death. Whoa, wait a minute, not so fast. Like martyrdom, chronic pain, rejection and abuse, I really don't care to know Christ that badly, we silently admit to ourselves. Is that true? Johnny goes on, most of us would love to experience the sort of closeness the Apostle Paul enjoyed with Jesus. We would love to have his faith and strength of character. We yearn to live that nobly, speak that boldly, fight our vices that manfully, and who wouldn't want to have prayers answered as Paul did? But to know Christ is always a personal invitation to suffer with Christ. No one enters the Lord's intimate fellowship without first entering his fellowship of suffering. Paul knew this. but it did not deter him. The sweetness of communion with Christ far, far outweighs the suffering. Johnny Erickson taught it. I want to know Jesus. I want to grasp why Jesus took hold of me. Not that I've already obtained all this or have already arrived at my goal, but I press on to take hold of that for which Christ Jesus took hold of me. I want to know why Jesus took hold of me. Why did he speak to me, that young 13-year-old kid? Why at 16 did he call me into ministry? Why did Jesus choose to take this shy, insecure, chubby kid and invite him to be his follower? Why did Jesus take you? Why did he call you at some point in time, invite you to follow after him? Why did he grab a hold of you and say, come, be my disciple? Why did he take hold of you? Paul says, I want to grasp why Jesus took hold of me. I want to get back to that spot and try to understand. I want to get a hold of this thing that Jesus has grabbed a hold of me because of something future, because he wants to take me to heaven, because he loves me so much, he wants to get me there. That's why Jesus took hold of me. So forgetting what is behind, no longer holding on to the stuff that's held me back, no longer giving in to the sin, no longer allowing that to be the controlling factor in my life, I'm going to strain. I'm going to press on. I'm going to fight as hard as I can get to that line over there, that finish line that's out there in front of me, the heavenward line. I'm trying to get there to be with Jesus because I want to know Jesus more. I want to grasp why Jesus took hold of me. And then Paul says, I want to win the prize. I want to win the prize that God has for me. Is that what it's all about? Just winning something? Oh, but this is an incredible prize. This is the prize of Jesus himself. I want to know Jesus so well that I get there to heaven and see him face to face. I'm going to press on to win that prize. We ask ourselves, ask yourself this question. How can I live so that my death, this is a serious question. How can I live so that my death will be an optimal blessing for my family, my church, and the world? What do you need to do to press on to that goal of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus so that when you die, your death actually blesses the people who are still here? It's probably not going to be the money you leave them. Besides, they fight over that anyways, right? So, how can you live? Let me ask this question one more time. How can you live so that your death will be a blessing for your family, your church, and the world? How do you need to live so the people will actually be left with, thank you, God, you? Paul goes on and says that if we're mature, we're supposed to live up to these things. Interesting phrase. If you're mature, you're supposed to live up to what you've already obtained. You've already come to know Jesus Christ. Now live up to that. Not live down to what you were in the past, but live up to it. Keep progressing. Don't fall back. Keep growing and serving Jesus until you die. Live up to what God has already done in you. You haven't arrived until you get to heaven. You're not so... how many of you are retired? Don't take this negatively. In the kingdom of God, you don't retire. You live until you cross the finish line going into heaven. You don't stop when you get to 60 and say, okay, I've done my part. I've served well. Sorry, this is not the time you get to rest. This is the time you get to enjoy more, because now you get to even more live for Jesus without a job being in your interruption and your interference. So there's no stopping serving Jesus at some point in time. okay, well, I've done my share. Now sit back and rock. No, that's when you die, folks. Live all the way into the kingdom of heaven. And that's what Paul says. Live up to it. Live all the way. Don't play down to some past level when you weren't serving Jesus. Instead, live up to him. And then he goes on. He says, I want you to follow a godly example. He says, I want you to follow me, and I want you to be a model for other people. All of us then who are mature should take such a view of things. And if on some point you think differently, that too God will make clear to you. Only let us live up to what we've already attained. Join together in following my example. I'm sitting here ready to die. Follow my example. Uh-oh. Brothers and sisters, just as you have us as a model, keep your eyes on those who live as we do. Really what's Paul saying is go be an example. Go be an example for somebody else. That's what discipleship's about. The best way to keep on growing as a disciple of Jesus Christ is let somebody else follow Jesus. You want to learn more about God and his word? Meet with somebody who doesn't know God and has questions. And it'll cause you to keep researching and trying to understand things. And you'll have to deal with tough questions. Live in such a way that your example is a model for other people that can point them to Jesus Christ. Are you doing that? Because if you're not, then you're not living up. I want to know Jesus. And I want you to know him more. And I want you to find somebody else who needs to know him as well. And I want you to be able to have your funeral and have us be there and saying, thank you, God. Not just we miss him, not just all the wonderful things, but thank you, God, for blessing us through your life. Live up. Earlier I read Ephesians 4, 22 through 32. I think it's a great tool that you might want to use as your own kind of analysis as to whether you are living up, whether you are following Jesus, whether you're growing as Christ's disciple. Because if you're growing as Christ's disciple, you'll be a servant. If you're growing as Christ's disciple, you're becoming more full of Jesus. Your relationships get stronger. You won't be swayed by deceit. You'll be able to discern the difference between truth and a lie. You will do the work that God intended for you to do. You're not going to sit back and trust your past laurels. You're a growing follower of Jesus Christ. You'll have a soft heart for the things of Jesus. If you're growing as Christ's disciple, you are going to put off the old self. You're going to start getting rid of sin and have a new mind. You're going to not allow anger to cause you to sin. You're not going to be lazy. That's why, by the way, when Ephesians was saying that, he says, those who are stealing, he's saying, those of you who aren't working hard on anything, get back to work, because you're stealing unless you're serving. And then he says, you will speak in ways that build others up if you're growing as a disciple. You'll not give bitterness a foothold. You'll not give Satan a place in your life. You'll be kind even to the least of his children, and you'll be compassionate because God has been merciful with you. Look at Ephesians 4, 22 to 32 again. Examine yourself and say, am I getting to know Jesus? Am I following him? Then calling the crowd to join his disciples, he said, if any of you wants to be my follower, you must turn from your selfish ways, take up your cross, and follow me. If you try to hang on to your life, you will lose it. But if you give up your life for my sake and for the sake of the good news, you will save it. And what do you benefit if you gain the whole world but lose your own soul? Is anything worth more than your soul? If anyone is ashamed of me and my message in these adulterous and sinful days, the Son of Man will be ashamed of that person when he returns in the glory of his Father with the holy angels. Pastor Jack Wellman has said there's four signs that you're growing closer to Christ. One, and I thought it was interesting, he puts this first, being persecuted for proclaiming the gospel. If you're increasingly doing what Christ did, then you are going to grow closer to Christ, and that you cannot be Christ-like without suffering like Christ did. And you know what? Too many people are embarrassed or afraid to talk about Jesus. Why? Because they're afraid they'll be rejected. If that's the worst suffering we face, we're not hardly facing anything at all, are we? But let's at least face that suffering. Secondly, Wellman says, being more sensitive to sin. You're going to be persecuted for proclaiming the gospel. Secondly, you're going to be more sensitive to sin. You see, the closer you come to Christ, the more you want to avoid sin, don't you? The closer you come to Christ, the more you want to be like Him without sin. Thirdly, the third sign of a growing disciple is a person who desires to be in the body of Christ. If you grow closer to Christ, you desire to be with God's people. It's His family. We are His body. And we want to connect to the rest of the body, to encourage, to build up, to use the spiritual gifts that God's given to us so we all can grow. And then fourthly, we want to seek to serve more. If you're increasingly serving others in the church and in the world, you're going to grow closer to Christ. The more you serve other people, the closer you get to Jesus Christ. Didn't He say that? When you've done it to the least of these, my children, you've done it to me. Four marks of a person growing closer to Christ: being persecuted for proclaiming the gospel, being more sensitive to sin, desiring to be in the body, and seeking to serve more. I want to know Jesus more than I already do. What about you? Jesus, forgive us if we've stopped growing. Forgive us if we're not growing by being an example to somebody else. Forgive us if we're afraid of suffering somehow for You, afraid of persecution, afraid of difficulty. Forgive us, Jesus. I pray that You would increase the hunger in each one of us to get to know You more. And I pray not for a head knowledge, but a heartfelt knowledge of You, Jesus. Pray for a deeper relationship for each one of us. Pray that the very ways we behave, our thought life, our actions around family and friends and on the job and in this community would be different as we get to know You more. I really want to get to know You more.